Hi, and welcome to another episode of All Around Azure. Today, Senior Program Manager and former Cloud Advocate Anthony Chu joins me to discuss a number of topics, including Azure Static Web Apps, Durable Functions, and a project called Custom Handlers. We'll also take a deep dive into one of the Learn modules that helps us understand what Durable Functions are. So with that, here's Anthony.
Cool. Yeah. So Static Web Apps is a fairly new product on Azure. It makes it really easy to deploy a static web app, I guess, for lack of a better way to say it, such as React, Vue, Angular. We mentioned Blazor earlier, as well as these static site generator created sites like Hugo and Gatsby. These sites require some sort of a backend, but you don't really want to kind of like create, build, for instance, a node, like an Express.js server, just to have it sitting around and waiting for a few requests that might come from the front end. So we allow you to create some backend APIs using Azure Functions, and then you can deploy those at the same time with your static assets, and we take care of deploying both of those for you at the same time.
One request Anthony's team gets all the time is around using and configuring Apex domains. In other words, domains and URLs that don't require the www. Let's see what Anthony has to say about that.
A lot of people want to use Apex domains, which is basically the domain without the triple W. Currently you kind of have to do some workarounds to get that to work. But we're hoping to get some first-class support for Apex domains, including giving you a free SSL cert for it, hopefully in the next few months. And then I can kind of quickly cover some of the other features that we have, and I can talk about some of the things that we're working on. Yeah. So we have an integrated authentication model. So you can pretty much just, without doing any work, you have access to social login with GitHub, Facebook, Twitter, Microsoft, and some other things. And you can actually specify and say that these routes on my static web apps, so this is actually like your static assets or your functions that you have, you can actually lock them down to specific roles of users. So if you, for example, only want authenticated users to be able to hit your functions or to access certain pages, you can just kind of define a JSON file and we'll just kind of take care of all that for you. I talked a little bit about routing rules already, but you can also set up routing rules in terms of if you want to do any kind of URL rewrites. For example, it's a pretty common thing that you need to do for a static web app that, because a lot of the routing happens on the client side, that if a client kind of renders your route as like a pretty deep route with a bunch of /user/1, all that stuff, that only happens on the client side. So somebody bookmarks that URL and then goes back to it later, the browser is actually going to go ask the server for it, and if your server is not configured to handle that, the server is going to be like, well, there's no file at this URL that you gave me, and that's because it's a client side URL. What we allow you to do is you can create this thing called a fallback route. So you can say that anything that basically more or less generates a 404, like that doesn't exist, don't return a 404, but actually return a the index.html, basically like the default page for your static web app. And what that will do is the static web app to load in the browser. And then when the static web app loads up, it's going to see the URL, and then it's going to go, oh yeah, that's a client-side URL, I know how to do this. And it's going to go and render the right page. So that's typically how you deal with client-side routing in a static web app, is that you kind of have to do a little bit of extra work. So we make that fairly easy for you to do.
Finally, it's time to see an app in action. Next, Anthony's going to show off a client-side app. It's actually a game that allows people to draw from a shared page. And then we'll go on to talk about some of the improvements around deploying from multiple branches in the same repository within Azure Static Web Apps. And last, we'll take a look at some GitHub actions that are all related to that process. So let's go check that out.
This is one of the things that we built. So you can actually just draw on it. I think there's, you can choose a color. It might be off screen right now. We can choose a color, right? There's a bug as well, like when you resize, you lose the pen marks, but we'll worry about that later. So one of the things that I did was I actually took that app and I added a little bit more to it, because currently this is a completely client-side app.
Yeah.
And what I did is I added a server-side component to it, so you can draw with friends. So
it.
When you click this button, it actually goes and hopefully it works. If not, this will be a really short demo. And what it does is that it gives you like the special URL that you can go and share with some of your friends. So here, I'll just be my own friend and open up another browser. And what's happening behind the scenes, and also have to wait for this to load, is when I draw on it, it's actually sending it, sending all the strokes that I'm drawing on the screen.
Mm-hmm.
To an Azure function, and then that Azure function is actually relaying that to basically everyone who has this specific canvas open.
Next, I asked Anthony to give our audience a little bit of an overview as well as an update on Durable Functions, as well as take a look at some of the most popular use patterns. So let's look at some demos now that really help illustrate the capabilities of Durable Functions.
So Durable Functions is a way to orchestrate Azure functions into like serverless workflow type scenarios. So for serverless functions like Azure Functions, there are some limitations. So even though they're really useful for running stuff in really massive scale, as well as you can have consumption based pricing for what you use. Those are all really great things, really good properties of serverless functions.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the things that we've observed over the years is that quite often you might bump into things like, I want to run something for longer than the 5 or 10 minutes that my function platform provides for me.
Right.
And I'm not really able to do that really easily. Or I want to kind of coordinate a bunch of functions to do things all in parallel. But then when they're done, I want to basically do a fan out and fan everything back in to do a summarization. It's fairly easy to do a fan out in a serverless function. You just drop a bunch of stuff into a queue, and then that causes a bunch of functions to run.
Mm-hmm.
But then it's actually not a super easy problem to solve on like how do you know when all these things are done so that you can do a fan in. So Durable Functions allow you to orchestrate functions that way. And there's also some other patterns that we support as well. So this is a fan out, fan in of a Python Durable Function app. But this is the orchestrator function itself. There's not a lot going on here, but this is actually doing some real work. So what work this is doing is I'm calling another function to say, hey, give me a bunch of images to classify using a machine learning model. In this case, this particular function returns a bunch of URLs to functions, well, sorry, to images of cats and dogs.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea is that we're going to go and now take those and fan them out to multiple functions that can run at the same time across many, many machines in the cloud. So that's what this particular call is doing here. We're saying for every image ID, I'm going to call an activity function and pass it the ID. And then I'm going to collect up basically pointers to all these things I started, and then say, hey, please wait for them to finish. So this is the fan in part. So you can see that we're kind of one line to do a fan out and pretty much one line to do a fan in.
We always feel real lucky here at All Around Azure when we get to be amongst the first to see a new demo, and this show's no different. Anthony now is going to show off a project he's been recently hacking on to illustrate the fan out, fan in pattern with JavaScript tests.
Okay, perfect. So here's another thing that I've been hacking on. This is really fresh. Like I started this 2 weeks ago, but I wanted to see whether or not, and these are if I open one of these things, you can sort of recognize, these are just JavaScript tests. And I wanted to see whether or not I can use fan out fan in to run my tests in JavaScript.
Hmm.
So these are just, this could be something that you pulled out of, Mocha or Jest or some other kind of JavaScript testing framework. This is some JavaScript testing
mm-hmm.
code. It also happens to use behind the scenes this tool called Puppeteer, which is a way to drive headless Chrome Chrome headlessly. So like, for instance, if you want to run some tests against your website every hour, or you know, just run a bunch of tests against your website to make sure that, my e-commerce site's checkout still works. Mm-hmm. You would use something like Puppeteer and, you know, something like Jest or Mocha or something like that to basically drive those tests.
With only a few minutes left in our show, Anthony now shifts gears and shows us Codespaces and how easy it is to start developing straight from within GitHub.
Yeah, I'll quickly spend maybe like 2 minutes and tell you about how Codespaces can be used for something like Azure Functions. And this is kind of like something I've been experimenting with is currently to kind of get going on Azure Functions locally on your machine, you have to go and download VS Code. You have to install the Azure Functions extension, install the Azure Functions core tools, and make sure that, you know, like you have the right version of Java or Python or whatever you want to use to build your Azure Functions. It could take a little bit of time, right? So I was thinking like, well, what if we just provided an easy way to create a to get started? Mm-hmm. So I kind of created a template repo here with a dev container, and this is what kind of creates the environment for Codespaces. So here I'm just using a Docker image for Azure Functions core tools with Python 3.8. So all that stuff's already pre-installed. And I'm also saying, hey, make sure that I have, you know, the Python extension installed as well as the Azure Functions extension installed. So now when somebody goes to my repo and they click on uses template, and I think I've already done this somewhere else.
I'm going to put that.
And if not, we can do it
here.
Put
that template into the chat.
They can actually go ahead and say open in Codespaces.
There we go.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, okay.
And then they can basically say open this in Codespaces. And then, so what GitHub does is that it goes and reads that dev container definition, that Docker file, so understands which Docker image to pull down to start my environment in. As well as it reads that JSON file that I have that describes what extensions I need pre-installed and all that. So so basically, when somebody clicks the button, you kind of just get into an environment that's already pre-configured to do the thing that I want them to do. Yep. In this case, this is working with Azure Functions. So hopefully,
and
this
the interface is like kind of Visual Studio Code. I mean, it's a pretty familiar interface.
Yeah. There's actually a button, or if not a button, you can actually, there's a command that actually allows you to open in VS Code. So you actually have VS Code connected to your code space. Yeah.
You know that?
I think it's here. I'm not pre-announcing anything, am I? So like a...
You didn't sign an NDA, did you?
So if you kind of hop over here, maybe... Yeah, well, I got to make sure everyone else watching has signed the
it's
NDA
the benefits
as well.
Of,
but I think you can just right-click. Look at this, open in VS Code.
Wow.
Before we go, Anthony gives us a real quick update on a new project known as Custom Handlers that lets you run any language inside an Azure function. So let's listen in as we learn how we can get started with something like Rust or even Go.
Yeah, so like one of the things I've been working on is a feature called Custom Handlers that allows you to run pretty much any language that you want in Azure functions. So Go and Rust are probably two that the people have been asking for a lot. So hopefully that feature will allow those folks to be at least a little bit happy. Like, I mean, like it's still not full, you know, 100% like a first class language, I would say. But it allows you to kind of compile your Go or Rust app and run it with Azure Functions, and you have full access to all the triggers and bindings as you normally would with other languages.
That's great.
Every week, we like to set aside a little bit of time to explore a Learn module that's related to the topic we've been discussing during the show. There's been a lot of subjects that we've been talking about this week, but we decided to spend a little bit of time on Durable Functions. So let's take a look at a Learn module talking just about Durable Functions.
Take a look at our Learn module. Easier to see that way. But it goes over what is a durable function, of course, a lot of the stuff that you were talking about already, and the different function types, a lot of the same diagrams even that we were looking at over in the overview. And then, for anybody who's never been through a Learn module, there's always going to be some sort of knowledge check to just make sure, you know, you're not just skipping through everything, but you're actually retaining some of the information in here. And then I believe if I go back...
Thank you so much for joining us. Until next time, I'm Jason Hand, and this is All Around Azure.